So welcome everyone. Really delighted to have such a great turnout for today for a really exciting second installment of SOAR. My name is Tom Lawrence. I'm a professor of strategy here at the Saïd Business School. And I'm just going to talk for about 1 minute introducing the center that sponsors SOAR and the seminar format. And then I'll turn it over to Rohini Jalan, who will moderate the day. The Center for Corporate Reputation is an independent research center within the business school here at Oxford. The aim of the center is to understand how the reputations of organizations are created, sustained, enhanced, destroyed, and rehabilitated. And so it's got a very broad understanding of what reputation is and its dynamics. It's an incredibly active, vibrant center in the school. It's the heart of a significant amount of research, significant amount of postdoctoral activity, and really an exciting place to be associated with. The SOAR seminar series is a new venture for us. We started last month with a really fun talk by Paul Tracy and Neil Stott, and I think I even saw Neil in the audience here, so welcome back. The aim of this series is to provoke a dialogue on stigma, authenticity, organizations, and reputation. And the focus is on understanding how businesses, as they learn to deal with grand challenges around health crises, climate change, the disadvantages and advantages of certain groups, manage these interlocking issues of authenticity, reputation, and organizational life. We're trying to do something a slightly different with the SOAR series than a traditional seminar series. What we're looking to do is invite you to more of a conversation between people involved in this kind of research. And today we have a very exciting conversation that will take a behind the scenes look at a really interesting set of collaborations around food trucks, which I think probably been the predominant form of food sustenance for some cities this past year. The format is going to be a conversation between Daphne and Todd for about 25 minutes. Then there'll be a Q&A. We'll moderate, Rohini Jalan and I, who will introduce herself in a second, will moderate that. You'll put your conversation, your questions in the chat. And I actually will also sort of, sorry, that's not true. There'll be a Q&A where we'll ask you to put your hands up. You can put questions in the chat or put your hands up and ask your question directly. My apologies. We're changing things from one seminar to the next. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Rohini Jalan, who will introduce Daphne and Todd.
Thank you, Tom. Hi, everyone. My name is Rohini Jalan. I'm a postdoctoral research fellow at the Center for Corporate Reputation here at Saïd Business School. And my research interests, broadly speaking, relate to innovation and inequality. More importantly, I'm really excited to introduce two really great speakers today. First, we have Daphne Dimitri, who's an assistant professor of strategy and organization in the DeSottles Faculty of Management at McGill University. And she joined the faculty there in 2017 after a postdoc fellowship here at the center at Saïd. And she completed her PhD in sociology at Northwestern University. Now, as an organizational sociologist, Daphne investigates questions related to organizational theory, culture, economic sociology, as well as entrepreneurship. And she studies these issues primarily through qualitative research methods. Empirically, her research centers on the culinary industry. So she studies restaurant kitchens, pop-up and underground restaurants, as well as gourmet food trucks. We also have Todd Schiffling, who is an assistant professor of strategic management at the Fox School of Business at Temple University. He joined the faculty there in 2017 after a postdoctoral fellowship and Dow Sustainability Fellowship at the University of Michigan, where he also earned his PhD in sociology. Todd's interests include organizational theory, strategy, innovation, and sustainability. And specifically, he studies how organizational as well as political contexts affect market dynamics, often utilizing big data methods. And his projects in this area include, but are not limited to, employment during recessions, news discussion on financial risk from climate change, as well as community effects on the development of atypical business ideas like gourmet food trucks, among others. That said, I'll turn it over to Daphne and Todd to introduce their study for us. Thank you.
Thanks so much. Okay, so we thought we could share, we thought we could share a little bit about what we're doing, what the paper's about, and also some visuals, mostly just to make you guys hungry for dinner, I believe, on your end. So I'm gonna share a screen, so hopefully everyone can see that. I'll make it full view, and I'll turn it over to Todd to start off.
Thanks, Daphne, and thanks to Rohini and Tom for the introductions and really the opportunity to share this research and get your thoughts about it. We're continuing to work in this direction, as Daphne will pick up in a moment. And so, we'd love to hear, what ideas this triggers for you all. So to set the scene a little bit, going back to 2008, and it's hard to go back in time, but if we could, this on the left-hand side here, this is what street food was entirely. In the US, it was very stereotypical food, very homogenous food across all of these different vendors, also stigmatized questions about hygiene and sanitation and so forth. And there's probably a lot of different places where this new model of street food started, but the person that's gotten the most credit is a chef named Roy Choi, who created the Koji barbecue truck in the other image in Los Angeles in 2008. Had this meteoric success, not right away, but within a couple of years, meteoric success, becoming for the first time winning prestigious cuisine awards for selling street food and things like that. So this was kind of where our project started, was this puzzle and a related puzzle. The first puzzle of how did this disruption or dramatically different version of this category, I think we were really thinking in category terms when this project started, how did this new way of organizing street food achieve so much success? And one thing that was interesting at that point, or related to that, was how much they celebrated the fact that they were doing things differently and they weren't what you expected. And related to that, we don't have a slide about this, but the growth of these gourmet food trucks, as we call them, was heavily clustered in particular cities, had this classic long tail distribution of a few cities like LA and some other cities, Portland, Washington, DC, where there were huge truck populations. And then many sizable cities like Dallas and Memphis and other cities had, it took them a long time to have any food trucks, and the population continued to grow slowly. So this was what we were interested in. And I think next slide. This is from our org science paper, table one, defining the characteristics that distinguish this new from old models of gourmet food trucks. Really important points about doing things that are unique, that we're not just buying wholesale ingredients, we're making the ingredients ourselves, and our food is unique. No other food truck. There's another great paper on this topic, but by Scott Sonnenschein and co-authors, that look at how important it is for each gourmet food truck to have something that nobody else has, and how much they avoid having the same items. And there's a price component, and there's a class component, especially early on with the mobile phones. And really interesting from an entrepreneurship perspective, really interesting, fascinating backgrounds of the people that started these trucks. And this is part of plays into the story as well, as in 2008, the financial collapse, the financial crisis. And it really became like a storyline that there were numerous cable TV shows that were created, but also numerous movies in which the plot was some sort of office worker who reinvented their life. You know, they hated their life and they reinvented it by starting a gourmet food truck. So it became kind of a mythic storyline. And, you know, this is a bit of a tangent, but of course these are very difficult businesses to be in, but it had that appeal. So I think we could go to the next slide. And so this reinforces this key question or key puzzle that why do some audiences look at an organization that's doing new things, that's violating their expectations for a product or a market? Why do some audiences respond positively to that? And other audiences, you know, I've presented this to people who've been revolted by this picture. They've actually experienced nausea in viewing this picture, like a very physical reaction. And so that's what we were trying to understand is, was there something about these, bring that in with this long tail distribution of these organizations across cities, was there something about particular communities that helped this new type of street food overcome these barriers? If you've gotten a chance to glance over this quote, you can see that crepes are stereotypical street food in Europe, but are within the U.S. context, this was something new and creative and more gourmet. The stereotypical thing was that people were coming to this crepe truck and saying, "Can we have a taco? Can we have a burrito?" So you can see the expectations that audiences had for street food that these new trucks were trying to overcome. And what we get into is very much related to center and this issue of authenticity, and something that I hope we can explore more is how these gourmet food trucks drew on notions of craft, of if we went back to that table, of this artisanal aspect that we're doing everything in a very unique and craft way, and use that as a powerful framing, if you will, for understanding the value of doing things differently. And within authenticity, I think it's such a rich and fascinating area, and there's different models and typologies are proliferating and so forth. And we really build on one typology developed by Glenn Carroll and Dennis Whedon. And they think about craft as and a more innovative evolution of type authenticity, that we're not just doing the same things that were being done in the past historically, traditionally, but we're focusing on the methods that we use, these laborious methods and this artisanal direction. And that's the idea that we developed to and find a lot of implications of that in our paper. So I guess we have to go forward here. And, again, one thing that to note is that, so they did have a very unusual idea, difficult to even understand or comprehend when they started. If we could go back to 2008, nobody knew what to call Roy Choi's Koji barbecue truck. There were all these different labels that were floated to try to explain what they were doing even. But within these particular cities, it was in the US, there was just tremendous audience response. It was a gold rush. And this is a picture of what would be called a food truck rodeo or a cluster truck event. There were different names for this. The day we opened, over 300 people in line for our truck in Washington, DC. So where our study, where the org science paper developed. And I think, are you taking it from there, Daphne?
Yeah, thanks. So if you're interested in more, you can read the paper. Our new project, it's interesting because our first project was really looking at more the entrepreneurial side of things about people who founded these trucks and deciding to go into particular geographic areas and their reception. And now I think we're looking more like the aftermath of gourmet food trucks. How have people's taste and values for particular foodstuffs changed because of the presence of gourmet food trucks in the market? And the argument we're trying to make in a new paper we're working on, soon to come out in maybe like 10 years, is about their impact on the restaurant industry, and particularly restaurants that also engage in fusion or hybridized cuisine. So as the picture of the Korean taco shows, one of the things that gourmet food trucks do quite extensively is they engage in this sort of hybridized fusion cuisine, such as the case of Roy Choi, which is blending Mexican and Korean ethnicities in one particular foodstuff. And so after gourmet food trucks emerge, we start to see this more notably spread into the regular restaurant industry. And I just put some pictures here of some very perhaps well-known hybridized products out there in the market. On the left is the ramen burger, which is, you know, a hamburger where the two buns are not buns, they're actually made out of ramen. And then of course the very well-known cronut, which is a blend of a donut and a croissant and is delicious. And so what we decided to do is go to Yelp and basically see how are people's modes of evaluating restaurants that engage in what is typically called in the theory organizational spanning or two cuisines, bridging two cuisines, how are they evaluated and does that change over time? And in evaluating these Yelp reviews, what we find that's really interesting is that gourmet food trucks appear in reviews about other restaurants as sort of a way for diners to say, this is the new litmus test of my dining experience. And what comes out is that people just love gourmet food trucks. They are seen as cheaper, they're seen as more creative, they're seen as more accessible, and they're just simply a faster way to get your meal. So here are some Yelp reviews that talk to that. In again, reviewing another restaurant, saying, you know, the problem is the food is just so mediocre compared to the huge variety of food trucks, or you can walk one block and get a great gourmet meal out of one of the many premier food trucks that DC has to offer. And I should add, most of our data comes from the DC area. And finally, this is a newer Yelp review saying it made me wish that I had gone to one of the nearby food trucks. And so what we're seeing is this increasing appreciation for what is colloquially known as fusion cuisine, or what is theoretically known as hybrid categories. And what's fascinating, I love this example of this Yelp review, is even people realizing that they would have never expected to appreciate this hybridized food. So this Yelp review comes from someone who's reviewing, as pictured here, basically a cross between Mexican cuisine and Japanese cuisine, because they are burritos filled with sushi ingredients. They write, I certainly could have never pictured a day back then of me coming to a place that sells burrito-sized sushi rolls as their shtick, and even less likely that I would actually want something like that. But here I stood at Burrito's soft opening on Monday. And part of the story here is that you're starting to see a lot more of food trucks going into established restaurants. But that's not the entire story. It's that the very restaurants that historically have served fusion cuisine are now being appreciated and given more stars and more higher ratings, which is roughly what this graph shows, which is that the line that's going straight up is a number of 5-star ratings for restaurants that span categories. And we are really lucky to be working with Hee-Won Che at ASU, who has developed basically a way to measure how much an organization engages in bringing in multiple ethnic foods together. So how much do they span? How fusion-esque are they? And what we see is these restaurants historically have lower ratings in 2005, but 5-star ratings. But by 2018, which is when our data set ends in Yelp, they have significantly higher ratings. So I will end there, and I guess we'll go into a conversation. I'll stop sharing. Should we go ahead and just ask questions?
Yeah, so that's fantastic. So that's super interesting, Daphne and Todd. I have a bunch of questions. I think Rohini probably does, but equally, if anyone in the audience wants to put up their hand, and Yuri Machina just did. So Yuri, do you want to ask a question?
Sure, thanks. First of all, just fascinating stuff, right? And I think, all of us love food trucks and love the idea of food trucks and love the idea of studying them, right? But I guess I'm kind of curious. So, you know, I was having kind of a side conversation with some people talking about the notion of like, yeah, I think the fusion food trucks, I think they're great, but is that kind of dependent upon the local trends? So I'm thinking like, you know, here in London, man, you know, it's like I found like one Mexican food truck and I was like, I thought that was the best thing in the world because I can't find like good Mexican food. And I find kind of a lot of fusion food that's like, that kind of comes across as like mediocre. And you know, I'm wondering if these types of things might matter. So that, is it really that people are searching for fusion versus certain categories? Or is it like, you know, I'm kind of bored with this. There's a lot of this. So let me find this alternative. And I'm kind of also wondering what the relation of that might be to the notion of authenticity. So I guess that's kind of a lot.
Yeah. So I think it's all about this typology, which Todd mentioned of Carolyn Wheaton, and of the type authenticity and the craft authenticity. And it's not that, so they argue in their piece that craft authenticity is kind of subsumed over type authenticity. But I actually feel like what we observe is the two are starting to coexist. But people are beginning to love craft authenticity as much as type authenticity. And type, when I say type authenticity, I mean people are going after something that fits into a category and a well-established norms of that category. So I go for authentic Japanese food because I have ideas of what that means. And craft authenticity is more focused on the producers, the production process, the ingredients, and the materials. I know Todd might have a different thought idea about this.
Yeah, sure. So I definitely resonate with everything that you said, Yuri. I think, you know, the thing that was important to us was that that you could have an overlap between craft and type authenticity, but that craft authenticity was more supportive to being innovative. Like you could certainly be doing traditional cuisine and doing like paying a lot of attention to the materials and like making all the ingredients yourself. If you were just, you know, if it was just about type authenticity, it would be hard to do something new and unexpected. And you know, like going back to this time period, 2008 to 2010, especially, you know, just doing, like, even if you were doing like a traditional cuisine and you were doing it really well, just to do that on the street was innovative and was unexpected and unusual. And it's kind of hard to go back in time and remember that. Within our sample, like we did see, you know, I think it was more common to be doing more of a fusion thing and a lot of different approaches to that, like a lot of different sort of versions of that fusion idea was the modal approach for these trucks. But there were also a lot of them that were doing a single cuisine, like from a craft perspective. But then again, it was often cuisines, to your point, that were unusual for that region. So like, I think some of our favorite ones were like, what were the people in Portland doing? They were doing like Guam food from Guam or something.
Oh yeah.
And you know, there's just nobody else doing that, I guess. And the other one that comes to mind, though I guess it's more of a the fusion one, is the person who is doing like Scandinavian flatbread sandwiches or something.
Yeah, there's some crazy ones. But yeah. To your chat box, just quickly, what's really interesting about this process is that you're right. At least in 2008, the Korean taco was weird and funky. But now in, you know, 2021, it actually has built its own type authenticity around it. And so it's all, you know, authenticity is a social construction. It has no temporal bounds. So it's just shifting and changing, which is a really cool thing to observe.
There's a couple more questions in the people hands up, Hung and then Rupert.
Hello, you hear me?
Yeah.
Thank you for your very delicious presentation. Each time I have some difficulty in academia, I always think about one day we open the food truck like that. But what I would like to say with you is, it's not really a question. It's some information I think is good for your research. It is the first thing I think immediately about the photos you showed us is a business model named micro franchising. Because you note that the background of the founder is immigrant. So micro franchising gives some business package for poor people from a developing country, for example, to open up some food truck like that or some small business model like that. That is the first story. The second story is you talk about, based on your interview, that the quality of some food truck is sometimes mediocre, not very good meal, but maybe it is story in some non-French speaking country, because I would like to share with you a story, a case study, very famous in France. This is Nathalie Nguyen. She has the same family name with me. She's a French Vietnamese, and she opened for the first time of a food truck in Paris. And then she got the master chef in France. And then she opened a whole franchising restaurant based on that type of food truck, so selling Asian food. And this is the most Asian, the most famous Asian franchising food now in France. So she changed the concept of food truck. She changed the concept of small business like that is equal to the low quality of food. So you ask the question whether the food truck affect the food industry. But I ask myself the question that, do they have their own way of developing, right? Thank you.
Do you want to respond or do you want me to go to the next question?
No, that's great. Go ahead, Todd.
Thank you for sharing that story. I'm going to look that up because I feel like, you know, France probably had people starting food trucks probably had the biggest uphill battle in France with expectations for, you know, how dining should be and you know, certainly how a higher quality or higher status dining should be. Those barriers were probably the highest in France, I would, you know, as compared to other places. That's really interesting. I you know, and your points resonate with what we saw in the US too, that you know, it's a very difficult business to have a food truck because, you know, it's cheaper to get into. The entry barriers are lower in that sense, but you know, there's so much more variability and unreliability of, you know, where are you going to be located every day, who's going to show up, what's the weather going to be, is the truck going to break down or everything, and so it's actually a very difficult business to be in, and these trucks go out of business very quickly. And the more successful ones start brick and mortar businesses. And I don't know how many of them actually became franchises, but I know a lot of them wanted to be. So that's a very, you know, exceptional case to be able to do that. And I think, you know, just one other point that maybe is worth riffing off of that is some people, like, you know, in the US, like, people like to talk about entrepreneurship and they like to talk about the lean startup model of entrepreneurship. And so they view these gourmet food trucks as a perfect, some people view it as an example of that, that you have, you know, you have low cost and you don't overthink it. You just, you know, we saw that in our interviews, right? People don't overthink it. You just try something and your minimum viable product and learn and gain a reputation and an audience and move on. Daphne, there was a great quote about that, right?
I mean, the lack of thought between someone just seeing a food truck on TV and then going, someone saw a food truck on TV that night, went on eBay and bought a food truck for themselves. Like, it's like they jumped, at least in this early 2008 period, they really wholeheartedly just jumped on the bandwagon. And then many of them realize it's not a sustainable business. It's really, really hard to make money unless you're able, as in the case of this woman in France, to franchise it or move into a restaurant.
Rupert.
It's great, Daphne, great to see you, obviously, having been a fellow with us. So congrats on a really interesting couple of papers and perspectives. So if I may, I've got two questions. One is a sort of technical question. I thought there was so much interesting stuff in what you presented, but one of the things I found particularly interesting was the comments and questions about how much more exciting and the better quality of these food trucks versus what else was available. So I guess my question is this a question about authenticity in relation to certain competitive parameters? So for example, if my competitive set is McDonald's or Wendy's burgers versus a food truck, I guess that's a different case if I've got the ability to do a sort of Scandinavian fusion dining experience against a Scandinavian restaurant, which has just won a Michelin star. I'm guessing that there's a different competitive dynamic set, a comparative set. So I'm interested to how you think about that context, about the which I guess is a context question. And the second thing is, I was sort of interested and surprised that this idea of new and innovative equaled authentic. And I sort of would just like to understand a bit more about how you see that connection. So thank you.
Yeah, I think the last question I was supposed to ask you, Todd, which is, what do you think of the connection between innovation and authenticity? I will maybe start with the first, which I think is really interesting, of the competitive dynamics or parameters, to use the word you use, for food trucks have changed over time. So maybe one of the reasons why they were so quick to be adopted, well, even then it's puzzling because their competitive set was these old, you know, standalone street carts or loncheros, as they were known in California, that sold. I mean, they were nicknamed roach coaches because the fear was that you would go to these and you get, you know, food poisoning. And then all of a sudden you have Roy Choi, like Santorin, who has all this professional culinary experience and elevates. There's a big story of like class status here, elevate what was typically a lowbrow organization into a highbrow. However, over time now, the competitive set is not those roach coaches, it's middle status restaurants where I'm gonna go for lunch, right? I'd rather go to a food truck than hit up a Chili's, a McDonald's, a, you know, whatever, my local Subway, because it's gonna be more interesting, cheaper, faster, et cetera. Todd, do you wanna handle the innovation authenticity?
Yeah, just on that, or that competitive thing, I mean, that's the really interesting jump, because the authenticity anchor changes, right? I mean, your original anchor was truck against truck, which is the more real, authentic, original experience. And then suddenly you're having truck against bricks and mortar, I don't know, some sort of Armenian restaurant and an Armenian truck. I mean, it's kind of interesting. The reference points change.
Yeah,
definitely. And to pick up on the second point, I think that's like a really important thing for our paper, that that we hope to, you know, we do feel like we're I don't know if we're swimming upstream or, but there's an interesting discussion, debate to have around that. And there's been a number of other papers that have looked at craft authenticity, you know, solely in the sense of upholding traditions. You know, what is craft? It's doing something that people were doing 200 years ago, or, you know, or something like that. You know, and we, you know, this isn't our, you know, idea or innovation, that craft, you know, this comes again from this Glenn Carroll 2009 piece, this idea of craft as a more innovative, you know, potentially a more innovative approach to type authenticity. I think, you know, we probably developed that idea, you know, quite a bit more and connect it to our context, and you know, we have a number of hypotheses that develop it as well, and the data we have, but the basic idea is that, again, you don't, you know, if you're doing a craft thing, you don't have to be innovative. You can be doing something very traditional, but by shifting the focus from sort of the characteristics of the product, like, you know, we're using the exact ingredients that were used, you know, for 200 years, from shifting that to the process, that, you know, the sort of this like artisanal, laborious, creative, you know, that I slipped in creative. It's about, you know, it's about the artisan. And if it's about the artisan, then it can be about their unique vision. Or it should be even about their unique vision. I don't know if it's a US versus Europe thing or something, and a different sort of historical like framework, but like, you know, craft is huge in the US. It's just huge. Like, you know, when you think about Etsy and you think about microbrews and you think about all these things, but it seems to me anyways that craft in the US is taken in a much more innovative direction. if you look at microbreweries, that's a great example of that.
Craft, I reckon, is a sort of global thing. I mean, we have microbreweries, it was a mass explosion in gins over here, for example.
Yeah.
What I think unites them, I'll be quiet after this, but what sort of unites them is I think, and where I guess I was getting to is that this innovation tends to be, and craft in particular, I rather like your craft authenticity idea, but this idea that it's about small. So it's attention to detail. This idea of going back to original products with attention to detail. It's like the foraging movement over here. So a lot of restaurants are now doing foraging over here. And that's all really the story around that is going back to the authentic roots of original cuisine. So anyway, I'm going to be quiet, but very interesting. Thank you very much for answering the question.
Yuri's got a question, but I'm going to jump in before he does, just because I have a chance. And I just want to actually ask a little bit about sort of picking up on Rupert's question around the experience and authenticity, and a lot of your story is around the craft and authenticity. But, and I kind of want to pick up actually on what some people don't know you knew also do, Daphne, the study of pop-up restaurants and underground restaurants. And one of the things that seems to me quite important about these food trucks, previously living in Vancouver, which was a pretty big food truck city, is the minimal experiential part of the experiential dimension is very low for food trucks if you say compare it to underground restaurants and pop-up restaurants. And I wonder actually how much of it is more ecological. It's just, it's actually really cheap and easy to sample food trucks. And I'm trying to think from my own experience, did I think much about authenticity and craft? Not really. I thought about, was it good or not? And whereas I did think about craft when I went to certain sushi restaurants and other kind of mid to high level range, I thought a lot about authenticity and craft. And I just wonder kind of where does that fit in? I mean, so because there's an organizational story, but then there's a kind of marketing consumer story here, which is low barrier, easy to choose, and easy to observe which ones are popular because they have lines. And so there's just this kind of natural organic movement towards ones that are better at what they do. Kind of a little bit like Yuri was talking about in London, you know, just a move away from crap towards sort of better quality.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to diminish, obviously with pop-up and underground restaurants, the main appeal is this experience of feeling like you're dining at someone's house, but you're having a professional chef do it. Well, actually sometimes it's not a professional chef. Sometimes it's an amateur and that results in a lot of chaos. But there is still this experience, and I should say, this is what comes from the data, right? This is what Yelp reviews talk about, of going out and eating on the street. There's some like appeal, and maybe it's this omnivorous, highbrow, lowbrow fusion of tasting food and having that gritty street food experience. And at least when Roy Choi first started, we forgot to mention this, but Twitter is a huge part of this whole experience. That's where all our data, Todd like created this amazing data set of all the gourmet food trucks in the US from Twitter. People used to chase these food trucks. They would find out on Twitter where they would be located. They would then drive to go find them. I mean, Roy Choi would find itself, Kogi Barbecue truck would be in these random parking lots and like all over LA, and people would hunt them. Now it's easier, but at least in the beginning, that initial appeal, I do think the experience was important to it. And obviously marketing's huge. Like Todd mentioned in this Scott Sonnenschein piece, also on food trucks, having the most unique, different branded truck is really, really important. You see some trucks that are like decorated who like pigs and they sell barbecue. I know there's one like that in Seattle, or you know, they're bright pink. And the entrepreneurs talked about that a lot with us when we interviewed them, is that they really needed to have the most unique concept as possible because you have to stand out in a sea of trucks. And so maybe that means creating a burger with ramen buns, stuff like that. I don't know.
Your hands up.
I kind of had a question earlier, but now I feel like I have a slightly different question. And I think the slightly different question I was thinking about in terms of some of the things that you were talking about more recently, I mean, within the last 3 minutes as opposed to like 7 minutes ago. And I guess that is this, because I found the discussion about the innovation and authenticity fascinating. That was what my original question was about, but I'm going to pivot to something else. And the something else is this. So how much of this do you think is driven by a search for novelty in kind of a hipster sensibility kind of way, right? So I'm thinking about kind of like, if you take the hipster consumption status in a Veblen sense, right, then you're trying to find the thing that like no one else knows about, you know, the underground thing, the novel thing, the whatever. And I'm reminded of the Book Awards paper that Balazs Kovacs does, right? And so I'm thinking like, so is it really driven by that, or is it really driven by, you know, the sense of authenticity or something else? And might it differ across different types of audiences? Because if you think about like LA, London, Portland, a lot of these places, you do have a lot of people who are going to be like trying to find the next thing that no one else knows about. While, you know, maybe you might have something different if it's in maybe a slightly different part of the world. I don't know. I mean, what's your thinking on that?
Todd, do you want to go ahead?
Thanks for those points. I guess I have a sort of two side approach to it. Like, I think you're onto a lot with that. And at the same time, that was sort of like the phrase that we were always trying to avoid in our paper was hipster. We're always trying to, you know, trying to find, you know, a deeper connection to it. But an earlier version of the paper, we had really framed it as a diffusion story and framed it from this perspective of novelty seeking, as you said. And we found a lot of support for that. An earlier version of the paper had the distribution of votes in communities. And so there's a whole literature in political psychology about liberals are more open to new experiences and things like that. And we had, you know, and that was true in our data as well, that cities with more democratic vote had more of these trucks. It's also true that, and certainly, you know, certainly came out in the interviews, but it's also true that our observation period, I think, stops in 2013, but the diffusion on these trucks happens within 2 years almost. It's explosive. And, you know, just in terms of like penetrating new cities. And it's also true that, you know, the cities that were slower to adopt, they catch up, but they don't catch up all the way. And so, even once these trucks are played out and there's stories in LA Times about how they're, you know, they're boring now and things like that, even after that point, there are, you know, disproportionate sizes of these truck populations in those cities. I think, you know, and that's implied in the authenticity idea too, that that there's this initial thing where this is unexpected. I think Daphne mentioned this is unexpected, but then it becomes expected. And like, you can get Korean tacos in the freezer aisle at your grocery market, you know, at any grocery store, and you can get them at Applebee's. And so it becomes a new category itself. And we'd like, I guess we could still write that diffusion paper. But I guess, so our point is that, I'm sorry for rambling on here, but I think our point is that the appeals to craft authenticity is what helps. It's not just new; it's appealing. It's not just something different, but it's appealing because of that. Daphne, did I lose the thread there? did I go off track?
I think it's great. Okay. I think we have like 15 papers we want to write off of this subject. I would just add, if you're interested in the whole hipster authenticity, and I have a tough time disentangling actually what hipsters are going for. Ultimately, I think is about this search of authenticity, although it's ultimately an illusion of authenticity. There's a great book by Richard Osigio called Masters of Craft. I highly recommend it. It's really cool. Like, it looks at Brooklyn, New York, so hipster central.
You know, Todd and Daphne, this conversation about diffusion is making me think about the kind of impact that these food trucks are having on the restaurant industry, just broadly speaking. But then also, you know, when I think about like Roberta's in Brooklyn, this tiny pizza place, which has like a Michelin star, and I'm thinking about status systems especially among food truck systems, like how do you award status to food trucks? Or do they even like fall into the same status system as restaurants with respect to like Michelin or other types of ranks?
Well, Michelin has not started evaluating food trucks yet. However, we end our paper with a story of the place in Singapore that's like in the metro that got a one Michelin star. So I think that they represent this broader movement of high status dining being democratized and broadened with these sort of more historically low status elements and being appreciated for those elements.
Yes. Tyson, you have a question?
Hi, yes. Thank you, Todd and Daphne. And my question is actually kind of related to Rohini's point there. In terms of thinking about what's next to these food trucks, and I guess the question could be stated as, if authenticity is something that they're gathering or garnering as they go, is it coming from somewhere? Is it potentially related to like the P.F. Changification of all the brick and mortar restaurants? And do you think that's a push or a pull effect? Thank you.
I think that's what we're trying to deal with in our current paper. I mean, I think we're trying to show that it's an after effect of the, we're trying to show that there's a mechanism through which this diffusion of this unique appreciation of authenticity occurs. And that is gourmet food trucks. That there's, you know, this, you have to have sort of like a well-appreciated atypical organization that valorizes then what other organizations are going to do. I don't know, Todd, do you have anything to add to that?
Is that phrase copyrighted? P.F. Changification? we are trying to develop that, as Daphne said. And I think the thing that we're maybe it's sort of an audacious claim, and to tease out like where does cultural change come from, and there's just the thing that maybe gives us reason to think that gourmet food trucks had such a big effect was just how much attention they got. Just like what, like if we could go back to that time period, like it was just insane how much attention they got and like how much notoriety, and like they just, like again, like they were in all these, they had multiple cable TV shows, they had like multiple movie plot lines. It was just sort of like the zeitgeist at that time period. And what we're trying to argue, or I guess how we're theorizing, another thing we're theorizing in this new paper is that, you know, you could have an established restaurant that does fusion like P.F. Chang's, and then that they won't have the same impact that a new type of organization like the gourmet food trucks might have, that there's something about having what we would call a new organizational form that, you know, drives greater cultural change, like gets audiences to, you know, not evaluate what you're doing against existing categories, but spurs them to sort of rethink like what is fusion and what is, you know, how do I find something that is appealing? Do I use these existing categories, or do I look for things that are spanning, or that are, you know, that different versions of spanning even? But we appreciate your ideas on that, certainly.
Nice. Aoife, you have a question?
Yeah, thank you. I really enjoyed reading your paper plus your presentation. I'm definitely gonna have a different view on food trucks from now on when I go have a burrito, a sushi. So in your paper, you focus more on like explaining where to find these food trucks. And let's assume, you know, if I were to consider opening a German sauerkraut food truck, because obviously I'm German, what would you recommend to me as such an entrepreneur, not just in terms of where, but maybe in terms of how? Because I imagine that, you know, from all your interviews, there's so many parts of your findings that didn't make it into the paper. So I just was wondering about that. So imagine me with the sauerkraut hat and then recommend away. Thanks.
Well, I think that'd be a great idea for a food truck. So one of the other indicators of how popular of a movement this was is there's so many how-to books now of how to start your own food truck. I mean, they are out there. You can download them. I think my response is I would actually say don't start a food truck because they sound like pretty miserable operations to run. You're very temporally bound. Like any restaurant, you know, restaurants are temporal worlds, as per Gary Fine. And so you are only operating during a certain moment of time. You don't have any of the luxuries of a regular restaurant kitchen. Your truck, I mean, there are so many stories in our interviews about my truck breaking down on the way to go, you know, serve lunch, and then there's no battery left and all of the like cold meats go bad. And so that, I mean, not to be a pessimist, but it does sound, that's the irony, right? Is that it was so popular and so many people jumped on, almost like a pyramid scheme to start a food truck. And yet it sounds from these interviews a really difficult career, and not a sustainable one long term.
Can I pick up on that? Because I want to ask about push even more broadly. So kind of picking up on Tyson's P.F. Changification, what about food truckification? And so if you were thinking about this as a more general phenomenon, and you said, okay, I'm an entrepreneur, how do I food truckify some other industry? And in a way, partly what I'm thinking about is part of your story isn't a million miles away from a classic kind of Christensen disruption story, low cost, low end of the market, building up, etc. But I'm just wondering if you were going to sell, you know, turn this into your bestseller airport, how to get rich or management or entrepreneurship book, and you were going to apply it to other areas, What would be the lessons, or what would be the model? How would you food truckify something else? And you can use that if you want.
Yeah, thank you.
Todd, do you want to answer that one?
I think I'm not as pessimistic about the food trucks as Daphne is. I think it is a great opportunity to you know, to try something out and to get your reputation out there, and then quickly switch to mass producing sauerkraut and putting that into stores. I think maybe this is something else that would be of interest with the center is how did they get so much attention for themselves? Is they took this like stigmatized category and they kind of inverted it. Like they took, you know, they said like, hey, this is, we're taking this this lowbrow thing and we're bringing like, you know, we're updating it for hipster sensibilities where, you know, it's a very problematic kind of class story in a way, but it was very effective in garnering, you know, and, you know, from a critical perspective, we could say like, there's not really as much different about these organizations as they claim that there is, but they were incredibly effective at drawing that boundary and garnering attention to themselves in doing so. So maybe there is a generalizable thought there. If you can find like a stigmatized part of the market and sort of invert the understandings around it.
We have questions from Rita and then Keisha.
Thanks. Hi, this was really fascinating. I guess I was just thinking about the other side of the market that you were talking about, so the traditional food truck owners. And I'm not sure if you actually observed this, but I was wondering if you identified some sort of shrinking of their market share and if that is somehow associated with the gentrification of urban areas.
Yeah, unfortunately, that's a story that doesn't get told very often. I mean, these truck owners came in and really sort of took over something that was historically an immigrant operation. I know there was a dissertation written a while ago about this gentrification process in New York, but I don't know anyone who has specific data on if that has taken away from their market. I know the restaurant owners hated these food trucks in the beginning, and they still do, in particular because food trucks, you know, they have a mobile element to them. So during lunchtime, they'd park right in front of a restaurant and basically take away their business. And so there's a lot of work with the restaurant association to sort of block these food trucks. I don't know much about more historical street vendors.
Yeah, I don't know either. My guess is that they aren't as competitive as you would think, that they have different niches. In New York City, they had a strict cap on the number of licenses for street food vendors, and that sort of and you know, and limit on spaces, right? Like spaces are at a premium there. So there was definitely a competitive dynamic there, I think.
Thank you. We have a question from Keisha Lashley, who actually, before she asks her question, I'm just going to introduce to you briefly, because she's actually our next speaker in this series on April 22nd, not to sort of confuse matters here, but since you're here, Keisha, welcome, and you have a question?
Yes, I do have a question, and thanks for the introduction. So you guys talked, first of all, really interested in studies. It's great. You guys talked a little bit about the like transforming the stigma. And I'm curious, I don't know if you guys have this in your data, but I'm curious to know whether you guys have any insights into how this was done. I know Daphne, a second ago, you talked about in the previous iteration of food trucks, it was primarily with among like immigrant populations and so on. So maybe that was part of it, but are there other factors that maybe transformed the category from something that was stigmatized to something that was kind of seen as more highbrow, I guess, as you guys put it? And I think along with that, Daphne also said that, you know, you shouldn't start a food truck, but I'm curious, tagged onto this idea of converting it from something that was stigmatized, like what are some of the recipes for success, or are there any recipes for success in this particular category?
This is why we work really well together, because I'm the pessimist and Todd is the optimist. So I always bring the negative side. Those are some great questions. I know I keep answering first. So Todd, do you want to go ahead?
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
Okay, so one of the interesting things that happens early on, so really Los Angeles is sort of the birth city of these gourmet food trucks, and it is really celebrities, chefs who are coming in and elevating it. So Roy Choi was not necessarily a celebrity chef. He did have experience in kitchens, but then we quickly see Ludo Lefebvre, who was a Michelin star chef, start his Ludo Bites, which was a fried chicken truck, and that brought a lot of attention. There were some other celebrity chefs, which is a classic story, right? You have these sort of high status actors come in and they pay more attention to like low status goods, and this sort of elevate them. How do you start a successful food truck? I think it seemed to be in our story, if you were early, I mean, Chef Roy Choi has been hugely successful in translating this concept into restaurants. I'm sure that I have a lot of data on that and from the interviews, but I have not gone into it. I should look at it to see what people's recommendations. Unique concepts, have a routine so people know where you're gonna be. That came out a lot. Todd, do you remember anything from our interviews on that point?
I think everybody we interviewed was tremendously successful. So I don't think we're really in a position to say why they were successful. Yeah.
So we
interviewed. Great to see you. Thank
you. We interviewed.
So as a follow up, I mean, is it mainly about these high status actors, or like that when you started off the presentation, you had those two images, the one of just the cart, and then you had next to it the truck. So what if those people had like changed the way that they did it in terms of going into a food truck, just taking the cart and transferring it to a food truck? Would that have helped? Or it was something else.
Go ahead.
It was again, sort of reiterating here, like they were tremendously successful at drawing the boundary, you know, defining this. There was this idea of something called a gourmet food truck, that they were doing something different, and it was inverting what previously had been done before. And so there were, you know, everything they did in some sense was about boundary creation or boundary drawing that way. You know, the different type of the truck, the use of Twitter, the type of the menu, the mobile location. Like if we went back to that table, like everything they did was geared towards trying to convey and communicate that we're different than what you think about street food. And we're inverting all of the stigma about it.
So I hate to do this, but we're actually at the end of our time, and I don't want to to push people away because we're running over. This has been so interesting, and the and it's really a fantastic second seminar for us, because there's already sort of themes building across the things you're talking about, and in a very different context, you're bringing us to think about issues around boundaries, both material and social and aesthetic, and the kind of evaluation of those and how we manage those boundaries, which I think is incredibly important for organizations very broadly, you know, as well as obviously in the super exciting restaurant industry. Just before we go, first I want to say thank you so much for being here, for the work you've done, for doing such an excellent job kind of bringing us into this really interesting world. So thank you. The second thing I want to do is thank Keisha for appearing briefly and just give a brief advertisement. April 22nd, this same place, wherever you happen to be, it'll be the same place. And it'll be April 22nd at 3 o'clock. Keisha and her colleague, Christy Lockwood, are going to give a paper, and I just want to make sure I get the rest, summer, at least to get the title right, which is called Contending with Janus's Two Faces, Managing History to Preserve Organizational Reputation. And again, it's a nice extension to what we're already talking about. It's looking at the University of Virginia and its effort to contend with its relationship to slavery and its founder, Thomas Jefferson. So in many ways, as far as you can imagine from food trucks, and yet actually also very, very strong connections in terms of trying to understand the boundaries of social organization and how we evaluate social organization. So thank you, first of all, Daphne and Todd. Thank you, Keisha, for being here. Thank you all for being here. Thanks, Rohini, and we'll see you in a few weeks.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thanks.